Welcome to this quick little tutorial on working with timing and loops and samples, how to cut samples out of longer phrases, how to cut loops out of longer phrases, and generally what you're looking for when sampling, essentially. So if we have a look at this example one track here, this is a two-bar loop. I know it loops because I have gone in and found the loop point. I'll do a video on exactly how to find the technical loop points of things and all of the theory behind that. But this is just a quick and dirty way of how to get a loop that you like in time with the project, and what is necessary to do that and what might be detrimental to the original flow of the loop that you're working with. So the first thing that I try and do is, if it's a two-bar loop and there's two bars in the original section, then I will try and identify where that point is that it resets or starts the next, you know, where the A section is and where the B section is, and try and find that and stick it to the first downbeat of the second bar, putting it in time. So if we listen to this, I'll click where I think the reset is, and we can have a listen afterwards and see if I've got that right. Let me just unmute. So this, in my opinion, needs to go on the two here, which is the first beat of the second bar. My next port of call is to try and find where the beats two and four need to fall. That's going to be your backbeat or your snare. Now, usually you could just count in. Once you found this, you could go, okay, well, that's, you know, it's going to be, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. You could count, you know, you could count to 8, you can figure it out. But this bar doesn't have a note on the first beat. So, you know, is it because I've sampled it wrong? Is this actually, does this need to be over here? Or what's going on here? So let's listen to it again and see if we can ascertain if there is just a misbeat or whether there is a rest that is needs to be cut out. So there's a couple of things going on here. First of all, our section is too long for the two bars. So the easiest way to do this is just grab a warp marker or adjust the BPM playback speed so that you get it back within that two bar window. And then also, this does appear to be the first note that you hear in the first bar, but it's the second note that you hear in the second bar. So in other words, they're not playing the first note of the phrase in the first section. Now if we have a look at this note here, which is, to my ear, this note here, it falls on the offbeat, or the second, what is this? This is, if we put this into eighths, where are we? Ah, triplet, that's why. It's the second eighth note. So this wants to be here, which, as you can see, puts our note on the two. So I'm fairly confident that these two points here are in line. So to double check, we can run the metronome. As you can hear, these two are in time. We've got a note here, and on this one, it's actually held out a bit longer. Here and here. With these, I'm going to suggest need to be on the second backbeat. And then again, that puts these very close to the kind of mirror of the last hi-hat. on of the bar. So let's run this through again, and let's see if we can hear if it's in time or if anything else needs to be adjusted. So at this point, it's pretty good. Now, if you wanted it to be even tighter, you could grab this beat 3. You snap those to a grid or not. It depends what else is going on in the composition. Again, you can go in and make all of this really tight. And, you know, that might be fine. I'll just do it just to prove the point. But essentially, what you've done there is you've removed the original player's feel. You've stuck it completely to the grid. This is essentially quantized now, which might be fine if you're doing a very busy composition and you need these things to be in place. If you're going to be running a drum machine alongside it that only knows what quantization is, that you can't play with swing, it can't play with human feel, this will now have a very different vibe than without those 16th notes in place. But this is handy if you're going to run it alongside a drum box. You know, if you put some accents in on a drum box or a drum VST, maybe you've got, you know, I'm just using a 707, but maybe you've got a acoustic VST that you use. And, you know, you need things to be in certain places. I'm just going to put this in roughly. This is sort of what the beat is doing. And we can listen to this alongside and see if this is correct or whether the beat needs to be changed. I would always say that if you're working with a loop, though, you want to use the programmed stuff to accent the loop as opposed to the other way around. A couple more kicks here, isn't there? But they're not as loud, so I'm going to bring the volume. So, quick one on timing there. But if we pull these out and have a look at something a bit more organic, this is a rip of Lynn Collins' Think About It from 1969-1970. And if we just play the first little kind of 12 bar section, bring this in. So there's a couple of parts in there that are very iconic. I have duplicated the original sample down. I'm just going to call this one Vocal Loop 1. And we're going to try and find that iconic loop that we've all heard from in here somewhere. So it's starting somewhere around here. Somewhere around here. So if we loop this section and essentially trim it down, we can now play this and we can fine tune our sample start, our in and out points. So right away, we don't need any of this. So I'm gonna set 1.1.1 there, bring that across, and just to keep things clean, I'm gonna crop it. Thank you. So as you can hear, that's not looping, but this is the first point where I would consider this would be a cut. This isn't quite a loop yet because obviously it's not looping, but this is where you would, you know, if you're going to go off and sample a bunch of records, you want to get all of your materials to this stage before you start really fine tuning it, because you might find different loops interact with each other, and you might find that you end up cutting things in different places based on what they're doing in relation to other loops and samples. With that said, though, we're only working on this one to begin with, so we're going to see if we can get a 2 or 4 bar loop out of this. The reason for those numbers is traditionally they loop well. So I'm just going to play around with this. I don't know where it's going to loop exactly, but I do know that this at the moment is a little bit too long, so I'm going to bring it down to 6. Well, it's actually a 5 bar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we may end up cutting this section out. We'll see. It is also worth noting it's sped up a little bit, because all I've done to get it to fit in that 5 bar is literally sped up the playback speed. Not the tempo speed, but the playback speed of this sequence. So, as you can hear, this original bit at the beginning here, if I actually just loop the section so we can hear it. This is actually, we're going to come back to this in a minute. This is one of the more famous parts that you can loop to get a rhythm section out. But we'll come back to that in a second. But essentially, for our vocal section, it's not needed, because this, these 4, with a little bit of manipulation on the timing, should loop. So that's sounding pretty good timing wise. I'm going to go ahead and crop this. And now we've got a 4 bar vocal loop. Now, because it is vocals, we're going to bring this down to Complex Pro, which is a different algorithm. Instead of it prioritizing transients, attaching it to the grid, it's looking at the pitch as well as the playback speed, which is helpful when you're trying to preserve the tone of instruments or vocals. But for this, we want to preserve the lyric. That is the iconic part of this loop. So we're going to use the Complex Pro. Now, because this is essentially a soul or a kind of a rock beat, we're working with a 4-4 drum pattern. So we can work with 8s or 16s on our grid. I think it's going to line up better with the 16s with our hi-hats here. We're not actually going to be quantizing the hi-hats, because they need to float in their own time to retain the feel of the loop. We're going to be looking at the main downbeats and just making sure that they're tight and it has enough punch. So first thing we're going to do is go with all of the kind of round numbers or the big numbers here, and we're just going to make sure that these are in fact on the grid. Now you can go in, you can zoom in on these and really fine tune them. I'm not too fussed on this particular loop because I think the looseness is part of the character. So now that we've got those in time, and I'm just going to double check by pulling out that this is again in the where it needs to be. So the next thing to do is again just to go ahead, and I always do them beat by beat in order, because it you might find that by pulling one in, it adjusts the others a little bit more organically than you physically putting it there. I'm going to leave the offbeats, these, because they don't need to be pulled in to retain that feel. So this now should be pretty much in time with our metronome. The hi-hats in between and any other percussion in between will float around a little bit. But if we run the metronome along this, our main kick and snare should be pretty much in time. And that was the main test there, to have it come back in on the beat. We kind of knew it would because we put it to the beat, but it's always a good test that if a loop really does loop on the beat, every beat, because it's going to loop, then you know that you've got a good little bite, and you can save it away on your hard drive, and you can use it in multiple compositions. Once you've got it, you know that you can cut to the grid, you can bring it into a range view, you can cut one bars, you can cut notes out of it, you can move elements around. We'll be doing a bit of that with the drum break that we're going to isolate in a second, and I'll do a separate video later on when we look at combining drum loops to create more rich patterns. So if we have a look at this section here, which again is the same part that we've just been working with, right? So we bring this back to the first bar here. You've probably heard this if you've listened to any jungle or even hip hop. The first thing I'm going to do before I cut this, though, is this beat here on the beat 2 here just wants to come in a little bit, because as you remember, we set that as our 1 on the other one, so we didn't need to cut it, but it is in fact the last, it moves everything back in time in the first bar. But once we've done that, we can crop the sample. And if I clean up the grid here, let's go with 16s. So you can see, if I just put in the yellow warp markers, you can see that they're not quite on the grid, which may or may not be a good thing. If you're doing more polyrhythm-based things, then this can actually help you, because it will add a bit of swing and a bit of layering and a bit of interest to your loops. For us, I'm going to show you how to put it in time, because you can always move it out of time if you need to. So as you can see, we've got our little handles in, and we're just going to pull them over and that should be this one here. I'm going to put in time only because we have a large section of audio here. These little hi-hats and things, I'm not too worried about. They're going to add a bit of movement to the beat. So this is one of the three quote-unquote think breaks. this has been used all over. From, you know, Will Smith has used this in his early rap career. You get it in hip hop. Everyone in the like 80s and 90s probably has used this or a version of this break. So if we have a look and if we can see if we can find another one of it. Now it's really quite simple to find drum breaks, because essentially all of this has bass energy or lyrics or something else going on, as you can hear. So essentially, when you're looking at a waveform, anything that looks like a big fat squiggly line here is probably going to have music alongside it. And the classic thing to do when you're looking for samples is looking for drum breaks, because traditionally, you know, it takes a lot of space to record drums, and if you're working on tracks in a flat or in a residential area, you might not have access to a drum kit. So if we start looking from here, if I set 1-1 here, there's another think break in this region here. And it starts roughly there. And it ends roughly there. So if we just, you know, loop a section and crop it down, we can go in and fine tune. And this is exactly the same method you'd use if you were using a hardware sampler. You would record a passage in, and then you would use the parameters on the hardware to trim the beginning and ends. So you can hear it flamming at the end. That's because you've got another kick coming in on top of this. So we just need to bring our loop point back. And again, we're going to look for that point where it's, you know, pretty flat. I would say there's pretty good. And you can check also in Ableton's really handy, because you can check down in the bottom left-hand corner where it says length. You've got length 2 seconds, and you've got a 1.00 length, which is 1 bar. So it's looped it, and if we bring this back, that was our plus, our 0.00 plus, was that, you know, half a beat over, and this should now loop at 1 bar. And again, we're going to do exactly the same thing, because it's just a variation of the first one that we did without the middle kick. So now we have think 2. And now, if you play these back to back, you've got a nice little A-B section. And again, there is actually a third section of this. Which you've just heard. It starts roughly around here somewhere. So if we go loop and we go crop, there's our kick. Yeah, so if we rename this one, where are you? There you are. Come up to think three. And now with a little bit of launch control, we make that one and then play next. You can hear them all together. So once you've got these loops going, you can, you know, you can really mess around with them. So I hope this has been kind of helpful on how sampling works, at least in Ableton, and how isolating even one bar loops. I mean, these little breakbeats here, they're one bar. They're four downbeats. You know, they're very small. But it's you know, it's amazing how such a small snippet of audio can be worked into a larger track. Anyway, I hope this has been rather useful. It's gone on rather long at this point, and I will try and figure out another video. Maybe we'll look at layering drums along with how to build polyrhythms in the next video.